Just Jenny. That's all. Right here on SiriusXM Stars.
All right. Let me welcome back to the show Karina Heimrich. She's a national on-air wellness and lifestyle TV personality, integrative nutritionist, and celebrity health coach. Welcome back to the show. How are you?
Wonderful. Thank you so much for having me back.
So, Karina, this time of year, everyone's kind of freaking out because it is the summer. I think a lot of people have kind of gone back into life as they once knew it, and they're going out more and they're eating more and they're drinking more, and their hours are kind of not as maybe regimented as they had been. And so I think that some people are feeling a little out of control or feeling like they could gain weight and they don't want to.
Exactly. I think for a long time, we have been comforting ourselves. And as we're all emerging, people are starting to realize, okay, it's time for me to start to get things together. I need to get rid of the comfort food and really know that people are going to start seeing me in person again, not just my head in a Zoom. So it's a wake up call for everyone.
Right. And so, and that is kind of scary for some people. I think sort of this reemergence beyond kind of feeling like you don't know how to engage with human beings in person. I think there is that idea of being looked at, which I like to remind people that nobody really cares what you look like. Like, you care what you look like, but nobody else is going to really appraise you the way that you appraise yourself. People just don't care enough.
100%. 100%.
They're caught in their own. They're much more consumed with themselves than they are sort of with you. But what can somebody do starting now to feel a bit better, to feel like they can rein it in, to feel like they can lose whatever bloat they might have? What are some of the tricks?
Absolutely. And I think you said it correctly. People want to feel good right now. I think we've gone through a really up and down year. And so this isn't necessarily, normally I would be doing all these shows on like, you know, get bikini ready. And people don't want that right now. They just want to feel their best. People want to sleep better. They want more energy. They want to get rid of that extra stuff. So there's simple things that people can start doing right now that will go a long way. So I have some top tips. Clearly, we want to make sure we are drinking enough water. This is something so simple. I feel like before this, we would carry a water bottle with us wherever we went. And now when you're at home, I feel like we drink less water because we actually have to actively go into the kitchen and get some. So drinking more water, I always tell people to drink water at least 30 minutes before each meal. It is proven to reduce the amount of calories you're going to drink. So right there, that is an energy booster. It's a metabolism booster. So simple. We want to make sure we are looking at what we're eating for breakfast. Now, not everyone eats breakfast, which we can talk about later. I'm very big proponent that you just need to listen to your body. It's no longer that you need to start with breakfast, but if you are starting
breakfast.
I do too, but I also have so many clients that love intermittent fasting and it's becoming all the rage. So we can talk about that. But if you are a breakfast eater, it's really important. And this is not a cliche. It's proven to start the day off strong. You want something with high protein because it's been shown that it can actually affect what you're going to be eating and craving later in the day, even as late as like afternoon and early evening. So we know that high protein breakfast, like egg whites, things like that, berries even, will reduce your cravings. We want to start getting rid of all of that added sugar. I don't tell people to get rid of sweet things, but I definitely teach them that they can use things like cinnamon. If you're used to putting a lot of crap in your coffee, that is a huge one that you need to start replacing it. Either drink it black and get rid of all that extra sugar we've been eating because sugar
But Karina, if you just have, and by the way, you can follow Karina at the Karina Method on social media, Karina with a K. But do you feel like if you have one cup of coffee every day and that one cup of coffee has sugar in it or whatever is your creamer and a little bit of sugar or a lot of sugar, if it's just one cup a day, is that really such a big deal?
You know what? When my clients start drinking black coffee, the added calories that we know that go into drink add up. And it's such a game changer. And they realize that they would rather hold out for those calories. And you know, I'm not huge on counting calories.
No, but I get it. A calorie is a calorie. Sure.
Yeah. And it really does add up. Not only that, but it does affect your sugar levels. So if you're starting your morning off with putting stuff in your coffee, you're already starting off with chemicals or sugar. When I would say, let's check out and see how you feel. Sometimes people just do it out of habit and the ritual of it versus that there's, you know, that they actually need it or enjoy it. So that's like a simple little change in your coffee that could go a long way of how your mood even, and how you react to things later in the day. Another one is just adding in more whole foods. This sounds so simple, but it is amazing how much processed foods and crap that we are constantly grabbing. I tell people to spend one day just taking pictures of everything going in their mouth. And, you know, a lot of people say, well, I eat really healthy. That's like such an easy term to use. I said, well, spend a day just for your own awareness of the quantity that you're eating and the types of foods you're grabbing. And people are really shocked when they see just how many processed foods they're actually eating in a day. So switching out that plate with whole foods. And then also eating slowly, getting away from your computer or eating in the car, and being really present to what you're eating. It's been shown that you actually can feel full sooner and reduce those weight, you know, gaining hormones.
Yeah.
So those are simple everyday things. We're not reinventing the wheel here. And then quality sleep. Now, this has been a year where I've heard more from people that their sleep has been so terrible. And we know that this is a really big risk factor for weight gain. It affects our metabolism. It affects that cue that you're actually full during the day. So doing what you can, whether it's taking off your phone earlier, drinking chamomile tea has been proven, trying to get to bed even 20 minutes before. These are all things that people know about, but I think it's really good to hear it and reinforce it and say, you know what, I can do these simple things and even take three of these things and add into my day to day. That'll make a huge difference of how you feel. And then another thing I tell people is the workout. Sometimes when we put it on our calendar and schedule it like we would any other Zoom call in our life or meeting, it holds us accountable to actually move that body. And we know that, food, I think, is something that people need to work on more than the workout, because the workout gives us that immediate, endorphin and makes us happy. Yeah. And so it's easier for everyone to work out, but it is important as well, because I think when we're working out and when we feel good, we're more likely to then make the choice to want to feed ourselves healthier things. So it does work together in creating that healthier lifestyle. So those simple things.
I think that you're right about, when I think about the black coffee thing, I mean, I am an intermittent faster by nature. It's just, I just do it. It's not, if I wake up hungry, I'll end up eating food, but often I don't need anything other than my coffee in the morning. But my coffee is a ritual. And by the way, I don't even have the coffee until after I've gone somewhere between 14 and 15 hours typically is when I get my coffee. Typically. Now, are there days that it's at 12 or 13 hours? Sure, but it's never before 12 hours, because I do put a creamer in my coffee, and I just switched to an oat powder that I love, but I was using Coffee Mate. I just kicked the Coffee Mate 10 days ago. It took me forever. It's a huge thing, because Laird Superfood Company came out with a new creamer that is so good, and I was like, okay. And so now that's my life. But coffee for me is almost a ritual in the morning. Like I love my cup of coffee, so I don't want to have it black, because I won't love it as much as I do. But I do know there's calories in it, so I count the calories. I don't think that I'm having no calories, because I know that I am. And so, but then my first actual food of the day is often like low fat cottage cheese. Or something similar to that, that's protein, eggs, cottage, like that kind of thing. But I get, if I could give up and just go to all black coffee, I don't know. I don't know that I've done it at different times. Like I've gone through phases, but right now I'm attached to my coffee. So I feel like that's okay. Like I kind of think you have to find what are the negotiables for you. I mean, exactly. I could stop eating at 6 o'clock at night if I have to, fine. I work out every day. Yes, but the exercise for me is much more about my brain than anything else. And I think that, And you know this, that for weight loss, it's like 90% what you eat.
It really is. I mean, I think it would be interesting for you to just chart how that coffee affects you. And if the creamer, you know, I have clients that are like, Karina, I will do everything else, kind of like you said, but there's no negotiable. You would be, I spent so much time talking about creamers and sugars and coffee.
I'm sure.
It's mind-boggling. It's like people will not get rid of that. That is, they're like, I will drink so less hard. Wine. I'll have one, you know, I'll do desserts. Yeah.
Because it's a ritual.
Yes, it is a ritual, but they all try it at least once. I would say more give up the creamer and keep the coffee and say, you know what? I don't even miss it. I thought I would. And it was our biggest conversations at the beginning. So it'd be interesting for you to just see, I know you said you won't enjoy this much, but, and right now maybe it's not the time. You're like, I've given up this and that. And now this is not the time to take my coffee away from me. But how long have you been doing intermittent fasting?
5 or 6 years.
And you do it
longer than everybody, every day, every single day. It started in, maybe 2014. If I look back in my emails, I had on a guest named Amelia Freer, and she's a dietitian out of the UK. And she said the thing that changes everything is, and for her, it was just the 12-hour fast. She was like, you go at least 12 hours from your first bite to from your last bite to your first bite or first bit of calories, 12 hours. And I was like, you know, I could do that. And at that point, I had no sort of eating schedule, no timed eating 6 years ago. And my weight wasn't heavy. It was just at that point, it was probably similar to what I am now, but it was still in my head, made me feel much more in control. And what she said was the 12-hour fast resets your digestion. That when you do that 12 hours, your body, it doesn't just like sort of empty out, but it gives your digestion just a rest. And I liked that philosophically. So that was for a few years. That was all I did, was just that 12 hours. And sometimes it was hard because if I finished eating at 10 o'clock at night, then I would have to wait till 10 o'clock in the morning to have my first sip of whatever. But now it became sort of chic to do the long fast. And I can't do the 20-hour fast. That works against me. Like my sweet spot is anywhere from 12 to 16 or 17. It's usually really 14 to 17 is like my sweet spot. Anything beyond that, not great for me. I guess I could do 18, but 20 hours, terrible.
16 is really, so anyone listening that doesn't know about intermittent fasting, this has been around for centuries, and it really has been studied. It's shown for weight loss, fat burning, longer lifespan, you know, improved insulin, cellular repair. Anyone can try it. I always recommend the 16-8. So like Jenny was saying, you kind of stop eating at your last meal, and then you wait 16 hours is really the golden hour, I feel like. And most people, obviously, you're sleeping for most of those hours.
Yeah.
But you're absolutely right. We spend so much time feeding our bodies and not ever giving our bodies a second to digest and actually register that they need nutrients and fuel again before we feed it again. And so this is such an gratifying way to take control of listening to your body. I recommend, I mean, if you're a healthy person and you checked with your doctor, that anyone try it. Even once a week, it has been shown to have these benefits. You don't need to do it every single day of your life, but I think it is addictive once you do start, because you feel so good just giving your body that little bit of a break.
I think you do.
To kind of catch up. Good. Yeah. 100%.
And I do think that for some people, there are some people that really, some people do a water fast for 24 hours once a week. I can't do. I can do fasting mimicking, I could do fasting mimicking diets for a few days, sure. And I can do my daily intermittent fasting of 12 to 16 hours, great. But when I go beyond that, if I do a 20-hour fast or a 24-hour fast, I end up overeating. I'm not, my body type doesn't work well with one big meal every day. My body type works well with a biggish meal and then all little meals. I can't have three big squares a day. That's not the metabolism that I have.
Much,
and
yeah.
that's yeah, way too much for me. But, you know, lucky well, people all, who get to eat three yeah. meals a day.
Well, we all eat too know. Much food. Like, in general, so we're all eating too much. And we're all in our heads. And we're all, there's this fear factor that we're going to starve ourselves and we don't know when the next meal is coming.
It's
and
so weird, Karina. It's true. You're right.
I mean, we're blessed. What, 99% of us can have another meal, thank goodness. And we're so blessed for that. There's very few people out there that are really worried, but yet we all were, you know, how many times have you told yourself, I'm going to be at this party. I don't know if I'm going to like the food. So I'm going to eat, even though I'm not hungry right now, before I leave the house, be that way in case I don't like it. And then you end up, of course, liking the food there and eating two dinners, you know,
right.
There's so many people out there that are so worried about food, and we just have to take it down a lot of notches and really know that we do not need all of that food unless you're training for a marathon. And I always, you know, people ask me, well, I need to fuel up after my workout. I mean, most of us aren't burning that many calories that we need like this full meal after a workout.
You're never burning the calories.
No.
You think that you're burning when you work out. And to your point about that we all eat too much, we do all eat too much. That's why if you look in your fridge, I mean, like my refrigerator and my pantry, they have there's so much food in it. It's and things go bad because I never get to that. Like there's just not that many meals I eat in a day. Like, yes, I have 21 chances a week to eat something different. And so you have to change your thinking. Like, if you really want to have ice cream at some point, then like figure out what day you're going to have it, and you don't have to have it every day. And
exactly.
if you do have it every day, then you can't have the other things that maybe you wanted to have that day. Like you can't, or I can't. I mean, maybe you can, but like I cannot have a bowl of pasta and then also have ice cream or frozen yogurt and then also have whatever.
No one can.
And think that somehow my weight's going to be what I want it to be. It's just not.
Wait, no one can. And I think you're right about thinking about when you can have those things. I think people also take so much time thinking about fitting in their workouts and leave no time, like literally 1 minute of your day, to just kind of think about your day and plan ahead and what activities you have, what you're going to eat. And I know that sounds like obsessive a little bit, but it's the same as working out. When am I going to fit that workout in, and what kind of workout am I going to do? It's the same thing. Okay, I have a busier day. I'm not going to be around for lunch. I'm not going to just grab something on the go because I know I'm going to grab the wrong thing. How can I plan ahead just a little bit? People that have kids do this all the time where they plan their meals out. But us as adults, it's almost like we don't want to be told what to eat and when to eat it.
Right.
And so what we do is self-sabotage all
yes.
the time.
Yes.
Instead of just making a simple plan. Okay, this is what I'm going to have for breakfast or not have for breakfast. And if I'm fasting, what are you going to break the fast with? And,
right.
you know, I think with intermittent fasting, people think, okay, I didn't have breakfast, and then they make up for it the rest of the day, which is completely counterintuitive by
True.
Overeating the rest of the day because of that lack of really caring about what you are going to fuel your body with. And if you're not moving a lot, then you don't need all that fuel.
Right.
So I think people
right.
need to enjoy their food for sure. But they also need to look at it. They need to start. We all need to start just taking that step back and thinking about what we are putting in our bodies and why, especially in this country, there's so much more illness and disease related to just lack of awareness with nutrition.
I think you're right. And I also think, to your point about we don't want to be told what to do or what to eat or what not to eat. There has to be a reframing in everyone's mind who chooses to go on a food plan or to change their body or change how they're eating, that it's a choice. Like you have to make it not about depriving yourself. You make it that you're choosing to eat the celery over the cookie, because celery is never tasting like a cookie. Like anyone who's going to tell you that it doesn't replace a cookie. But it can make you feel better if you want to be somebody who's choosing to eat celery over a cookie. Then that can work for your mental state. And you have to choose to have that philosophy rather than choosing to be like, oh, woe is me. I can't eat the cookie. Well, you can, but you might not be happy about it after.
Well, and I think by the time people come to work with me, they're so fed up with the way they feel, with the way they look at themselves in the mirror, with the way clothing is fitting. And I think, you know, getting back to how we started this conversation is people, it's time for that tough love to say, I want to feel different. I want to feel better. I want to sleep better. I want to be more energetic. I want clothing to fit me differently. And if you're saying all those things to yourself, then right. you have to know, then that means you have to make changes. And I always tell people, these That's are true. Not huge changes. You do not no. have to go on the juice mm-hmm. fast or the water no, fast no, no. or even mm-hmm. intermittent fasting. You need to make small changes in your life. And it means changing. Yes. It means going without, like,
but
you said,
that's a choice. Making, yeah.
It's a choice to yep. not have the cookie after every meal, but maybe all right, Friday let me... night. That's cookie night.
Exactly. All right. Follow Karina at the Karina Method, the Karina Method. She's terrific. TheKarinaMethod.com. Thank you for being back on my show. I'm sure I'll talk to you again.
Thank you so much.